Good morning, and welcome to the 18th annual Veterans Day Breakfast, the largest such event in Pennsylvania, if not the entire country. This event has as its main focus the honoring of those who have ever worn the uniform of the United States military. In so doing, we hope that all others in attendance will be patriotically inspired and left feeling grateful to live in this great nation. Following the presentation of colors, the Pledge of Allegiance will be led by World War II veterans, and then the national anthem be sung by our own Duquesne's Annie Marie Sykes. Then we will have the benediction, the invocation by Father Bill Christie. So we ask, if you're able to stand, to please do so. I would now ask for the honor guard of Vietnam Veterans Incorporated and ROTC cadets to please present the colors. Now we'll have the Pledge of Allegiance, led by our World War II veterans. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Christine.
Let us pray. God of all nations, creator and sustainer of all peoples, hear us, for you are our strength and our shield. We, current and former members of the military, gather with our family and friends this morning on Veterans Day to share this meal and to give you thanks for the devotion and courage of all those who have offered service under arms for this country. We pray for those who have fought for freedom, for our comrades who have laid down their lives for others, for those who have borne suffering of mind or body, of those who have unselfishly brought their very best gifts forward in the service of our nation at her times of greatest need. God, in your mercy and love, we thank you for their lives. With us and on our behalf, O God, many have entered into danger, endured separation from those they love, labored long hours, and borne hardship in war and in peacetime. God, in your mercy and love, we thank you for their lives. We pray, Father, to you, Father of mercy, and through the intercession of Michael the Archangel, patron and protector of all servicemen and women, for those who are now at war, encourage and heal those in hospitals, guard those in any need or trouble, hold safely in your hands all military families, and bring the returning troops to joyful reunion and tranquil life at home. Give us, your people, grateful hearts and a united will to honor these men and women and hold them always in your love. And our prayers until our world is perfected in peace and all wars cease. Bless the meal that we share this day. Bless those who have prepared it and those who serve it, that through all of this we might give you honor. Amen.
Thank you, Father. Please retire the colors. And please be seated. I'm delighted to remind you that this is the fifth year of the Veterans Breakfast at Duquesne University. I couldn't imagine hosting it anywhere else. I believe that this is one of the many reasons why Duquesne is indeed a military-friendly institution. There are currently 235 military and veteran students at Duquesne. But on Veterans Day, it may be fitting to recall when there were many, many more veterans attending our great school. In the years following World War II and the fall of 1947, the number of veteran students here at Duquesne peaked at 3,122. It comprised 64% of the student body, quite an astonishing number. We may never reach that milestone level of veteran student attendance, but I am sure that with our current leadership of our new president, the university will reach new heights through continued service to the military and veteran students. Speaking of leadership, before taking over as president, he served for 7 years as dean of Duquesne University Law School. He joined the faculty in 1994 after teaching at the University of Pittsburgh School of Law and engaging in private practice. President Gormley earned his BA from the University of Pittsburgh in 1977, summa cum laude, and was elected to Phi Beta Kappa. He received his JD from Harvard Law School in 1980, serving as a teaching assistant to Professor Archibald Cox in constitutional law. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my honor as a 1966 graduate of Duquesne to present to you the 13th president of Duquesne, Dr. Ken Gormley.
Thank you, Tony. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to a beautiful morning at Duquesne University of the Holy Spirit and one of the most significant Veterans Day gatherings in this city and perhaps in the United States. About a year ago, shortly after I was named as the new 13th president of Duquesne, I began a deep dive into the university's history. As Tony mentioned, I've been here as a law professor, as a law school dean for 22 years at Duquesne, but I quickly learned many things that I hadn't known that left me in awe, including the breadth and the depth of Duquesne's longstanding support for our nation's military. When the Holy Ghost priests founded this university in 1878, Our student body represented a very diverse mix of European immigrant backgrounds, mainly Irish, German, Eastern European, and the makeup of the student body mirrored that of the priests themselves. They came from Europe to assist recent immigrants and their families to be able to obtain an education, higher education, to give them new opportunities. Despite that melting pot that was this campus, with the outbreak of World War I, Duquesne's president, Father Martin Hare, made it clear that this university community was unquestionably and unconditionally American, summoning the students to a moving flag-raising ceremony on campus. Father Hare told them, and I quote, "The more a man loves God, the more genuine and the more self-sacrificing is the love of his country and the flag of his country." The first formal military education program, the forerunner of ROTC, was established on campus in 1917, almost exactly 100 years ago. 6 months after that, some 220 students and faculty had enlisted to serve their country, and in July of 1918, the first Duquesne soldier, Albert Mountain, died on a battlefield in France. This university's support for active duty service members and veterans has continued steadfastly for a century. Hundreds upon hundreds of our students, staff, and graduates have given the ultimate sacrifice, and they are remembered in our beautiful Victory Garden on campus back here along McNulty Drive. In fact, Father Henry McNulty, and I know many of you knew Father Mac, our ninth president, was himself an Air Force chaplain, retired from the reserves as a brigadier general, one of our special Duquesne heroes. And I've met many, just this morning, heroes in this room. One of them I ran into, Leo Plunkett, attended Duquesne Prep School, class of 1934. For those of you who don't know, the prep school doesn't exist anymore, but that was a kind of preparatory education for college. Leo graduated from the College of Arts in 1938, along with his wife, Ruth Morrissey, class of 38 in education. Spent 36 years, Leo did, in the military, was a World War II vet. And this year, Leo, can you stand up? Where are you back there? Leo, hold on. Leo just turned 100, and so I said he got his money's worth from his Duquesne education. So today, Duquesne is nationally known for its educational outreach and the services it provides to active duty personnel and vets under the leadership of our fabulous Director of Veteran and Military Services, Don Accomodo. Don, can you stand and be recognized, please? Where are you back here? And it is an honor each year to welcome this gathering of veterans, family, friends, civic leaders, and citizens who share our gratitude for your service and sacrifice. We, as a Duquesne community, are proud to play a small role in supporting the Veterans Leadership Program and the initiatives that it helps to sustain, including Shepherd's Heart and the mission of serving homeless vets, a just fabulous program, Friends of Da Nang and their work to restore lives in Vietnam, and now the inspiring Guardian Angels Medical Services Dogs for Veterans program. And also, Professor Dan Kuntz is here. Our veterans program, our veterans law clinic, has done remarkable work that has gained national attention. So many of these programs we are so proud to have hosted at Duquesne University. Duquesne's students, our faculty, and our alumni remain as richly diverse and a richly diverse family, just as we were 138 years ago. We come from now every state in the United States and more than 100 nations. We practice Catholicism and many, many other faith traditions. We come to this bluff from all walks of life, yet as in Father Hare's time, we remain united in our love for our country, in adherence to the principles of freedom that are embodied on these flags and the flag flying over this campus each day, and in pursuit of the distinctly American ideal of liberty and justice for all, and in appreciation for those valiant men and women who have made and continue to make all of this possible. So thank you for joining us today for this inspirational gathering, for taking the time on this most solemn day to reflect, to remember, to rededicate ourselves to the service of our nation. May God bless America, and may God bless each of you who has put your life on the line to protect these sacred freedoms for all of us.
President Gormley mentioned Veteran Leadership Program, which is the premier veterans advocate organization in Western Pennsylvania. For over 35 years, it has provided helping hands to veterans in our region. May I introduce Navy veteran Ben Stoll, the newly appointed executive director of VLP, who once was a part of a global force for good, and now plays the same role in helping veterans in our region. Ben Stoll.
Good morning. Thanks, Tony. I'm Ben Stoll. I'm a United States Navy veteran of Operation Iraqi Freedom, and I'm the executive director of Veterans Leadership Program. Before we get started, I'd like to make a few acknowledgments and thank yous. Thank you to Duquesne University for being our gracious host this morning. President Gormley, we're both Swissville guys. I was actually at St. Anselm's when your mom was still volunteering there, so I remember her well. And thank you to all of our sponsors this morning, Bayer, UPMC, Duquesne School of Nursing, and Allegheny Financial. And I'd also like to thank the organizations that contribute their time and their talents to make this morning possible. The Friends of Da Nang, Vietnam Veterans Inc., Shepherd's Heart, Duquesne University, the Veterans Breakfast Club, and Life Changing Service Dogs for Veterans. And I'd like to also give a special thank you to PNC, who goes above and beyond in their support for our veterans, not just financially, but through community leadership and involvement on boards, committees, panels, across the region and across the country. We're here today to honor our nation's veterans, the brave men and women who have so selfishly given themselves for the greater good. And I look into the audience and I see veterans from all eras, veterans from World War II, Korea, Vietnam, the Cold War, the first Gulf War, and the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan. We all know what it's like to give part of yourself for something greater. We all know the feeling of pride that is earned by working hard, completing the mission, and serving your country. Veterans Leadership Program exists to help those veterans who are transitioning, who are having a tough time, who are in crisis, or those who have slipped through the cracks. We're here to help veterans when they are in their truest time of need. So in 2015, Veterans Leadership Program provided permanent housing to nearly 150 veterans and their families. We provided nearly 500 veterans with homeless prevention and rapid rehousing assistance. We provided emergency shelter to 82 veterans and their families, keeping them together when they need each other the most. We enrolled nearly 450 veterans in our employment programs and have a 75% placement rate. We also provided nearly 1,200 veterans with supportive services to help them meet self-sustainability and help achieve self-sufficiency. VLP is truly a community asset. I've been with VLP since 2013 and was named executive director in September. I'm honored to carry the flame that was lit by the veterans who are in this room today. Thank you. As a veteran of Operation Iraqi Freedom, I'd like to thank the veterans from World War II, from Korea, from Vietnam, from the Cold War, and from Desert Storm. To the post 9/11 veterans in attendance, it is now our turn to lead the veterans community and to fulfill the sacred obligation to our brothers and sisters that the veterans before us have gone so far to uphold. It's imperative that we learn everything that we can from these veterans so that we can continue to be the men and women that they led by example, and we can carry the torch of their work and also honor their legacy and their contribution to the veterans community. So I'd like to leave you with a quote this morning that seems appropriate with the nature of the climate in the country today. It's a quote from FDR, and for those millennials in the room, that's President Franklin Delano Roosevelt. The thing they forget is that liberty and freedom and democracy are so very precious that you do not fight to win them once and stop. Liberty and freedom and democracy are prizes awarded only to those peoples who fight to win them and then keep fighting eternally to hold them. The people of America agree with that. They believe that liberty is worth fighting for, and if they are obliged to fight, they will fight to eternally hold it. This duty we owe, not to ourselves alone, but to the many dead and who died to gain our freedom for us to make the world a place where freedom can live and grow into the ages. Thank you.
Thank you, Ben, very, very much. No question VLP is a premier organization in our community. Now, last year at this breakfast, it was announced that an initiative, Life-Changing Service Dogs for Veterans, was being launched. Its purpose was to raise enough money to provide 22 service dogs at $22,000 each in 22 months. Today, 1 year later, we have prepared for you an update of our progress. This brief video will set the stage for our report.
More than 900 miles from Pittsburgh, there's a small quiet town called Williston, Florida. It's about 2 hours north of Tampa, and it's home to Guardian Angels Medical Service Dogs, a facility that is literally saving and changing lives. Six Pennsylvania veterans now know that firsthand.
Good boy, bud.
It's a tranquil 35-acre farm where at any given time,
let me see,
there are between 70 and 80 dogs.
Happy girl.
Mostly German shepherds at various levels of training.
Yeah.
Animals that will eventually be paired with people battling a wide range of mental and physical disabilities.
Everything we do comes from the heart. This is not a job. This is a passion.
Down, come in.
Good dog.
It's something that we eat, sleep, and breathe 24/7. You get the ball.
Carol Borden founded Guardian Angels Medical Service Dogs in 2009.
You've been digging.
But her love for training dogs started more than 50 years ago.
Look at that pretty boy. Look at that pretty boy.
Carol eventually realized her life's calling was to raise and train service dogs.
To see the dramatic changes so quickly in our recipients is my greatest reward.
I went over in Vietnam and
deployed to the Middle East.
I deployed for Desert Shield, Desert.
Many of those recipients from all over the country are veterans scarred by war.
We'd come home, they spit on us, they called us baby killers. It was horrible.
Some PTSD, a lot of depression, some anger issues.
Okay, come on, girl. Good face, good face.
Six men from Pennsylvania just made the trip south, thanks to Life-Changing Service Dogs for Veterans. It's an effort launched by Tony Accomando, a local Vietnam veteran and owner of Veterans Cable Services. Last fall, he set out on a mission to raise almost $500,000, enough money to pair 22 vets with dogs. The number 22, significant because according to the Veterans Administration, on average, 22 veterans commit suicide every day.
I could have killed myself many, many times. I felt, empty, lonely.
Look at me.
Depressed. I take so many drugs. They depress me. You're a good dog.
Joe McQuaid from Monroeville is a Vietnam vet.
Oh, come on.
And like so many, being deployed changed him.
Inside of you, you die because you're not afraid anymore. Stay.
Returning home was difficult, but now at the age of 65, Joe is getting a new chance at life. He's one of the six just paired with a service dog.
We went back to the motel. I slept for the first time since 1969.
All of the vets had similar instant connections with their animals.
That's me. Good boy. Good boy.
Larry Debar, a veteran from Homer City, suffers with mobility issues, PTSD, depression, and anxiety.
I always had a fear of when people walk up behind me. When they get too close, I start panicking, the anxiety kicks in.
In just days, Shiloh was able to help. In public places, the German Shepherd actually positions herself between Larry and other people.
Our furry little force field.
She's doing her job. She's keeping me calm.
Bring it.
Come on, Faith.
Bill Fennell is a Vietnam vet from Carnegie. His dog, Faith, actually detected anxiety during our interview and jumped up immediately. Faith reacted exactly the way she was trained to.
Good doggy, good doggy.
Before the pairings, the dogs go through about 1,500 hours of extensive training. It takes about 2 years. It begins with the basics of socialization and advances from there. They learn specific tasks based on the needs of the recipient.
Easy.
Some alert their partners before panic attacks and night terrors. Others go as far as to retrieve medications. All in all, though, these vets say peace has been the biggest benefit.
And this is
okay, girl.
Like a beginning, a new life for me.
Best friend.
It's really a new start for me.
I think I'm going to be a better person coming home. I'm finding myself wanting to be there again.
These dogs are our guardian angels now.
Sarah Arbogast, KDKA TV News.
Thanks, buddy. Thank you.
So now you've seen on video and maybe have read in the newspapers these brave veterans and their service dogs. But how about meeting them now in person? I'd like to introduce to you several, starting with Tom, Cannon, and Camo. Tom was with us last year and he launched this initiative. Bill Fennell and Faith. David Tylosky and Ringer. Joe McQuaid and Lily. Joe's struggling with a foot problem and he's been assisted by one of our cadets. And Lily. Ted Mackey and Chloe. John Kelly and Ranger. David Curran and Lima. And finally, Connor Green and Bradley.
Beautiful.
Connor's a Duquesne student, and Bradley will be in some of the classes and walking this great campus. How about a round of applause for all these wonderful dogs and their veterans? Now, just in case it has not become apparent why we are here today, please don't know it's all about veterans. It is the veteran, not the reporter, who has given us freedom of the press. It is the veteran, not the poet, who has given us freedom of speech. It is the veteran, not the campus organizer, who has given us freedom to assemble. It is the veteran, not the lawyer, who has given us the right to a fair trial. It is the veteran, not the politician, who has given us the right to vote. It is a veteran who salutes the flag. It is the veteran who serves under the flag. And at this time, I would like to invite all veterans who have served in the military, no matter where you were stationed or whether you were engaged in combat or not, to rise and be acknowledged as I call your name, given your era of service. First, those who served in post 9/11 are currently serving during global war and terror, including conflicts in Iraq, Afghanistan. Please stand. Maybe we'll just hold our, and just remain standing, please, and we'll hold our applause until everyone is finished, please. Those who served in Bosnia, Herzegovina, or Croatia, please stand. Those who have served in Somalia, Persian Gulf, Panama, Grenada, or Lebanon, please stand. Those who are serving during the Vietnam War, please stand. Those who served during Korea War, please stand. And those from the greatest generation, those who served during World War II, please stand. To all you defenders of freedom, we are honored by your presence.
Armstrong is proud to announce Healing Heroes in partnership with Guardian Angels Medical Service Dogs. Guardian Angels rescues, raises, trains, and donates medical service dogs to assist veterans struggling from disabilities such as PTSD, traumatic brain injuries, seizure disorders, and more. With the support of our communities, Armstrong's Healing Heroes aims to donate 5 service dogs to area veterans in the coming year. Armstrong will be matching all donated funds. For more information, visit us on Facebook. Together, we can unleash the power to heal.
And as you can imagine, an event such as this breakfast and an initiative to raise hundreds of thousands of dollars for service dogs doesn't just happen. Countless individuals and organizations have committed to the success. I would like to take a few minutes while you are enjoying your breakfast to recognize the following. First, the Duquesne University family, from President Gormley to the many members of the faculty and staff, including Bertie Krueger, Jim Miller, Nick Dubos, and Roger Brook. And this morning to the fabulous waitstaff serving us. And a special thank you to my kid brother, Don Accomando, the Director of Office of Military and Veterans Students, a retired Lieutenant Colonel in the Air Force, and a person who not only recognizes the need to recruit veterans to attend Duquesne, but one who has the passion to become involved in the veterans' lives once here and respond to their unique needs in a focused and compassionate manner. Next, we would like to recognize the Gold Star mothers and wives who have suffered immeasurably over the loss of a loved one who died serving in the military. We offer you our thoughts, prayers, and comfort. You must have been moved by the presentation of the colors by members of the Vietnam Veterans Incorporated. Their contingency, always seated in the rear because they leave and go directly to the parade, has been Pittsburgh's most consistent participants in parades, military funerals, the POW-MIA vigil, and any event needing military representation. Whenever you look around the room, you will see dozens of World War II and other conflict veterans, all members of Veterans Breakfast Club. Todd DePastina is the brains and brawn behind this great organization, which provides a forum for veterans to tell their stories. Actually, following this breakfast at 10 o'clock, they will do so right here. We welcome you to stay, listen, and learn. If you're enjoying leafing through the program, you might want to thank John Dezak, CEO of Printscape, an Air Force veteran. This breakfast actually had its beginning at the Marriott Hotel Center City on Veterans Day 1998 with only 32 attendees. As we outgrew that venue, we moved here to Duquesne. The original intention of our breakfast was to raise money for humanitarian projects for children in Vietnam. You can read about the Friends of Da Nang in the program. And speaking of Vietnam veterans, our friend and Vietnam veteran Chris Moore is here with his lovely wife, Joyce. Chris joined us on one of our trips to Vietnam and, along with WQED Television, produced a quality DVD, which is in country. You can read the names of the committee which planned this breakfast in the program. I would like them to please stand and be recognized. It's just a great job, everybody. It's just a fantastic job for this breakfast. The video which was shown earlier was the result of Sarah Armagast of KDKA, a really talented reporter and friend of veterans. Recently, KDKA has developed an initiative called Military Mondays that airs during the 6 o'clock news on Mondays. They feature up to 3 current military or veterans during each weekly feature and then post them on our special landing page. KDKA is proud to honor our local and current military veterans, and we thank them for this initiative. The patriotic cards were graciously prepared by Duquesne University's resident life and students at Markham Elementary School. Thank you, Dr. Robert Frau and Maria Albach, for organizing this. And also join me in recognizing J.C. Todd and Marianne Miller, the creators of limited edition artist book FUBAR, which is on display in the Gumbarg Library until noon today. And the Gumbarg Library is just across the street from where we are now. There are several postcards on each of the tables with a page from the book. The poem, told from the point of view of a female Air Force physician deployed in Iraq, was written by Duquesne alumna and award-winning poet J.C. Todd. Marianne Miller is the printmaker, designer, and binder of the books. Again, thanks to Veterans Leadership Program for organizing this breakfast. I believe we have several members of VVLP's board and staff with us, and I would thank them for their attendance. But the most important person in all of this is Army veteran VLP's Tasha Jarrett, who almost single-handedly put this event together. So Tasha, where are you? Please, there she is, hiding back here. The woman that put this thing all together, Tasha Jarrett. Almost single-handedly. What a woman. Pittsburgh Hires Veterans is responding to the employment needs of veterans. It's led by Vietnam veteran and former PA Auditor General Jack Wagner. Jack is here with Michelle Marketai. We would be remiss not to thank several longtime table sponsors for the breakfast. Duquesne Light, Tim Lynch, Tom Bagandy in Air Force, Andy Russell, Army, and my grade school friend and Marine, Bob Fragasso. And at the tail end of this program, you will be moved by the thundering voice of Reverend Michael Worsh, Air Force, who found and runs Shepherd's Heart Home for Homeless Veterans. He will be honored tomorrow night by Soldiers and Sailors Memorial Hall with the Friend and Patriot of the Year Award. Congratulations to Pastor Mike. At this event last year, the Pittsburgh Foundation offered a challenge grant of $44,000 for 2 service dogs. We met that challenge and more. With us is Lindsay Aristi from the Pittsburgh Foundation, who made that announcement. With us also today are several donors of service dogs, to include Joe Fairbanks, Jennifer Schroeder, and Bill Stewart. We thank you. Veterans Cable Services, along with Guardian Angels Medical Service Dogs, formed Life-Changing Service Dogs for Veterans, which has been raising money for these canines. I would like to recognize the members of Life-Changing Service Dogs for Veterans, along with Veterans Cable Services and his sister company, Gray Fox Services. As we know, successful projects require participation and partnerships, and 2 such partners are with us this morning. Armstrong Utilities is a company based in Butler, PA, which in part offers cable television services. Armstrong has announced that today they are launching an initiative to raise enough money with its employees, subscribers, and community members in 5 regions that they serve. And they hope to provide 5 service dogs in 2017. That's quite remarkable. By the way, Ed Marchetti from another cable company, Comcast, has been chosen to receive the Veteran Employer of the Year Award from Veterans Cable Services. Ed is here with his table full of colleagues from Philadelphia area. And now an incredible partnership. I draw your attention to PNC Bank and their tables of volunteers here today. On October 1st, PNC held the first annual Mutstrut, an event at Frick Park, which offered to have a fun time with dogs and their owners. That event, they raised enough money to date to purchase, I'm not sure, nine dogs, PNC. Can you imagine that? Our salute to PNC Bank, especially Mike Hudson and Greg Jordan, but in reality, it was really Chris Phillips, who just shouted nine, that Marine, Chris Phillips, who is the most driving force behind this incredible initiative. And now for our keynote speaker. The founder and CEO of Guardian Angels Medical Service Dogs, Carol Borden, titled her first dog at the age of 10. Professionally, Carol spent many years in the retail industry managing big box stores, providing her with knowledge and experience to take on a project organization such as Guardian Angels. Carol has well over 50 years as a dog trainer, which includes being licensed professional dog handler and a certified CGC Canine Good Citizen evaluator with the American Kennel Club. After being approached by a young man who had been unfortunately paralyzed from the neck down after a tragic high school football accident, Carol took on the challenge of training a service dog for him. This experience showed Carol the need for specialized training dogs for the disabled and her ability to positively impact lives through these amazing dogs. Life had been grooming her all these years, and she now knew that she needed to do less the forming of the Guardian Angels Medical Service Dogs. This organization currently has a 5-star rating on Great Nonprofits Org, a Platinum Top Rating Nonprofit Award for 2016 on GuideStar, and is listed as a certified mentor trainer facility by the nationally recognized Animal Behavior College. Carol was selected as recipient of the 2014 Stephen R. Wise Advocacy Award from Florida Rehabilitation Council for the state of Florida, and it was one of 6 nominees selected for the Joe Sanchez Award leadership, was selected as only one of 30 nominees of 4,320 people for the National L'Oreal Paris Woman Worth Award, and was notified that and qualified the president. Honors included letters from the president of the United States, Barack Obama, a certificate, and a commemorative pin for Lifetime Service Award. I could go on and on about Carol. You saw her in the video, but to see her in the flesh and hear her words of movement is something special. I'm going to invite Carol up now to address you, and please welcome the woman that's behind Guardian Angel Medical Service Dog that makes this all possible, the woman who has saved many, many lives because of her good work. Please welcome Carol Borden.
Good morning, and thank you so much for allowing me to speak with you today. I feel so honored to be able to speak to so many veterans in one room at one time. And at the risk of being redundant, I really think it's important to continually recognize all of our active military and veterans from all of the different branches of the military in all of the different encounters that they've had over the years. Some of these may have actually been forgotten or looked over. I want to start with our World War II veterans, then Korean War, the Lebanon Crisis of 1958, Dominican Intervention, Vietnam War, Grenada, Beirut, Libya, Panama, Persian Gulf War, Somalia, Haiti, Yugoslavia, Afghanistan, Philippines, Syrian and Iraqi intervention, Iraq and Libyan invasion. Thank you for your service and your sacrifice, as I know there have been many. Many of you may not know that Veterans Day actually began after World War I in 1919. But long before that, about 164 years before we dedicated a special day, one of our most famous military leaders and veterans was fighting for our country. Though he personally identified himself as a farmer, and few of us remember him as a veteran, he was actually George Washington, our first president of the United States. After being actively engaged in many years of war and fighting, just as all of our military are faced with, his military service came to an end, and he had to go back to civilian life. In doing so, he looked for a way to give back to our community and his country, thus ultimately becoming our first president. It was Washington's core belief that the nation had an obligation to embrace our veterans and share with them the fruits of the labor that had been so hard won through the bloodshed of the Revolution and other wars. He asked, "Shall not the brave men who have contributed so essentially to these inestimable acquisitions, retiring victorious from the field of war to the field of agriculture, participate in all the blessings which have been obtained?" Officers and soldiers, Washington said, may expect considerable assistance in recommencing their civil occupations from the sums due to them from the public, which must and most inevitably be paid. Simply put, we must fulfill our promises to those who have served. By choosing to attend this Veterans Day event, you too are demonstrating that you believe in fulfilling those promises. I am humbled to be surrounded today by so many of you. I'm blessed to have been invited here today by Veterans Cable, an organization that is deeply committed to giving back to our veterans, and to be blessed as the CEO and founder of our own organization that also has been deeply blessed and committed to helping many, many veterans. As Americans, we should be filled with appreciation and gratitude for the liberties and freedoms which have been secured by those willing to undertake the tremendous burdens of war. Because of their perseverance, our military have experienced the ultimate in sacrifice in our behalf. General Washington believed that for his soldiers to still be standing after 8 years of Revolutionary War was nothing short of a miracle. Yet, we have many of our soldiers today that have been through multiple combats and been for multiple tours of duty. How then can we return? How then can we not expect our returning servicemen and women to get anything less than what Washington professed in his day, that we owe our service people? Think of the veterans who have witnessed the horrific acts of war and how they must find ways to deal with it today. The needs of the Continental Army soldier from centuries ago were not so different from the needs of our veterans today. Our veterans need training for jobs that apply to civilian occupations and incomes. Our veterans need to be welcomed home with a commitment to their physical and emotional healing. They need time to adjust to a pace and a mission not determined by war, and a community that understands and is ready to meet the distinctive needs of our veterans, particularly those that have been touched by illness or injury due to combat. That is why Washington's centuries-old commitment to veterans remains our responsibility today. It is not the sacrifice of one veteran, but of all veterans of all American wars that have afforded us the opportunity to be here this afternoon or this morning in freedom. And it is the reason we continue to fight for better, more fulfilling lives for our military veterans and their families, day in and day out. which is not just an obligation, but also an outstanding debt of honor and our sacred duty as Americans. Every man and woman fortunate enough to live here as a free American, every person who has sought refuge within our borders, they have done so at the cost of a veteran's sacrifice. Today on Veterans Day, we honor the fallen, but we also honor those fortunate enough to make it home. For every serviceman and woman who pays the ultimate price, we have 10 others that come home that have been wounded. There are so many programs today across the country to help our veterans transition to the path of a successful civilian life. Yet still, no challenge could be greater than making that transition. I've never worn the uniform. I've never had to be away from my family and friends for years, months at a time. I've never been wounded in battle. I've never worn combat boots or eaten MREs. I've never had to shoot at an enemy or hold a dying friend in my arms. I have no idea what you have experienced, your fear, your bravery, your suffering, your survival. I know nothing of what you know. These are sobering thoughts on Veterans Day, a time when far too many American veterans are homeless on the streets of our cities or struggling in isolation from the scars of combat. Today, I ask you, as we honor veterans, to remember the promises made to men and women who were and are willing to give their lives to defend your families and the way of life that we enjoy today. I am proud to be an American. It is our freedoms that were won and defended by our veterans, the men and women who put our country before themselves. Veterans stood up when the country needed them, and now it's our turn to stand up for them. I feel it is an honor to serve my country. And I do that today, but not in the military. But by helping veterans every day through our amazing service dogs. They are able to bring veterans peace and healing, even making them whole again. For those that have lost arms and legs, our dogs can take over the tasks that they cannot do without their limbs. Our dogs can pick up dropped items. They can open and close doors. They can turn on and off lights. Imagine a life that you were not able to do that. Things that we take for granted every day. For those suffering from the horrific ghosts of PTSD, our dogs can stop the nightmares, the anxiety attacks, the flashbacks. There's a terrible problem in our country today when we have 32 to 39 of our veterans that have PTSD attempting suicide, with 22 of those ending in death every single day. That's horrific. However, once they've been paired with one of our four-legged angels, we have never had a suicide. Today, I ask you to pledge your commitment to our brave men and women who have served and sacrificed in our behalf. Don't just remember them today because it's a holiday. I challenge all of you to go forward from this day and every day to give back to those that have given so much for our freedom. If you can hire and train a veteran, do it. If you can start an organization that, say, maybe can train these amazing service dogs that we donate, do it. If you have any God-given gift, give it. If you can't do something like that, then support those who can by volunteering or donating your dollars to organizations like ours that work 7 days a week to give back in your behalf for our freedoms. I encourage you to do whatever you can to pay America's debt of honor and gratitude to our veterans. Do not take your freedoms for granted, as I can assure you our veterans do not. I hope I've been able to inspire you today, because I'm inspired every day by the difference our organization is making in the lives of our veterans. These veterans once came through my door in such pain that many of them were self-isolated for many, many years. And others came through my door so broken that they had had multiple suicide attempts before coming to us. But because we at Guardian Angels are paying it forward to those that made it possible, some of those same people are in this room today, standing strong once again with their four-legged guardian angel at their side. I encourage you to take time to hear their stories today, because their stories are of courage and leadership. They've been facing their most difficult battle yet by dealing with their disability. But today, they have become beacons of hope to those that are still in pain. So don't let this message and the meaning of today end at midnight tonight. Be inspired, be grateful, be thankful. Join me in paying our debt of honor to our veterans every day. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I would like now to introduce one of our service dog teams. This is John Kelly and the infamous Ranger. If any of you don't know who Ranger is one of our little bit older dogs. He was busy before we could pair him with his veteran because he narrated a book for us. And he was busy doing book tours and podographs. And so, but now he has gone on to live the dream that he talked about in his book, and he is now serving his veteran, John Kelly.
Good morning. First, I want to thank Carol, Tony, Veterans Cable, Duquesne University, thank you so much for putting this together. This is a wonderful, wonderful event. And it's something that means a lot to people like me. I'm a husband, a father, a veteran, a paratrooper, and I'm lucky to be alive. As recently as July of this year, I was in a place that was so dark, so all-encompassing, so suffocating, and so terrible that I had serious commitment to no longer being here. Serious commitment. It was about May when I came across the idea of Guardian Angels and medical service dogs for PTSD. I didn't know a lot about it, and I had heard and done some research for service dogs, but it wasn't a clear idea. Over the course of my application period, I met the wonderful people at Guardian Angels down in Florida, and they were truly inspiring, wonderful. It was a place of hope. I said to myself, I'm going to let this play out. I'm going to attempt to make it. But if I go down to Florida and I can not make a connection with the service dog that's provided to me, I'm not coming back. It was something I didn't share with my wife. It was something I didn't share with my family. And as I said before, I'm lucky to be alive. And I wouldn't say luck as much as a miracle. Guardian Angels gave me the best friend, and he loves to sleep. He's a sleeper. They gave me the best friend, advocate, battle buddy that I could ever ask for in Ranger. He saved my life. I remind Tony of this every time we talk. He says, welcome home. I say, no, you saved my life. So that's much more important. It is truly unbelievable what these dogs can do for people. I share my story and the reality of how close I came to committing suicide, not for an emotional moment, not for a convenient plug, but to put a face on a real issue that faces this country, something that takes up to 22 veterans' lives a day. We have in front of us, in Tony Accomando and Guardian Angels Medical Service Dogs, an answer. It is a true answer. And I can tell you from personal experience, if we could just put every veteran with a service dog, that number would be zero. So I implore you to continue to support, continue to donate, continue to advocate, continue to hug a veteran on Veterans Day. Because for every one of me, remember there are 22 others that we will never ever get to hug, kiss, thank, shake hands with ever again. God bless you, Carol. God bless Guardian Angels Medical Service Dogs. I thank you so much, and God bless you, Tony. Without you, I would not be here. Thank you so much for being here. Thank you so much for supporting the cause. It benefits people like me. Thank you.
Talk about proof of the pudding. My goodness, how inspiring, Carol. How inspiring, John Kelly. How inspiring, Ranger. And Ranger's book is over here for sale a little bit later on. Just an incredible presentation of love and warmth and survival. And now to bring this wonderful breakfast to a conclusion, I'm going to call our good friend, Pastor Mike Werschmidt, who is a friend of every veteran in the city of Pittsburgh, an amazing Air Force veteran who will continue the inspiration for you. And then we have a little bit of a song afterwards. So please, Pastor Mike.
If you're able to stand, please do so. We live in a region of our country unlike almost any other region that understands that we must never forget our veterans. Thank you for not forgetting the veterans. As a fellow veteran, I am committed to continue to working with you to help every veteran that needs our help. Please bow your heads. He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High abides under the shadow of the Almighty. He shall say to the Lord, you are my refuge, my stronghold, my God, in whom I put my trust. Almighty God, we have gathered this morning to honor our nation's true heroes, our veterans. We pray your continued blessing throughout this day, as our community remembers the great sacrifices of its fathers and mothers, sons and daughters, brothers and sisters, friends and neighbors. We thank you that these men and women, when the time came to serve true freedom, they answered the call to lay down their lives for truth. We thank you for the gift of the life-changing service dogs and guardian angels that have been provided for our veterans in need. We thank all who continue to make this gift possible. Lord, we will also continue to remember all the veterans who are here today. We will continue to pray for those veterans who are sick and dying and homeless. We pray your continued comfort for our Gold Star mothers and fathers and Gold Star families and all the families of loved ones lost in war. We cry out to you to watch over all the men and women of our armed forces who are serving in Afghanistan, Iraq, and all the difficult places throughout our world. We pray an end to these wars. Protect those that face the perils this very hour. We continue to cry out to you to answer our cries to bring our POWs and our MIAs home to be with their loved ones. Lord, would you give each of us this day the diligence to continue to make known the great sacrifice that so many have paid to keep our country free. Now may the Lord mercifully look upon you with his favor and fill you with all spiritual benedictions and grace, that in this life and in the world to come, you may be partakers of eternal life. Now the blessing of God Almighty be upon you, now and forevermore. Amen.
Rushes right to the edge with me, gives me TLC unselfishly, and then saves me from myself. And when we're out and about, when my invisible wounds just won't shout, comes and comforts me without a doubt. But it's just a talk. Just a talk. And when things just don't seem right, 'cause everything has gone awry, with all my feelings of despair, their love for me is always there. But it's just a dog. Just a dog. Take the number 22. It should resonate with me and you. It's for those who can no longer fight the fight and daily leave us. If only they had someone there who understood, who was aware. Is it so hard when back home, that even when in company we're all alone, then you see them sitting there, the wagging tail, the puppy stare, my guardian angel, a part of me, who love me unconditionally. But it's just a dog. Just a dog. Just a dog. Just a dog. But it's just a dog. just a dog. No, he's just my dog.
We thank you for coming. Enjoy the Veterans Day.